gives me great pleasure to introduce to you this evening our first keynote speaker of this, our second theology symposium, organised by our Theological College together with the Sydney College of Divinity. Aristotle Papanikolaou is Professor of Theology and the Archbishop Demetrius Chair in Orthodox Theology and Culture at Fordham University. He's also co-director of the Orthodox Christian Studies Centre there, where he has dedicated much of his time more recently in building an intellectual community. He has initiated the Triennial Conference on Orthodox Catholic Dialogue, the annual Orthodoxy in America lecture, and most recently a peer-reviewed journal titled The Journal of Orthodox Christian Studies. Aristotle was born and raised in Chicago, Illinois, and after graduating from his undergraduate studies from the University of Chicago, Professor Papanikolaou went on to Holy Cross Greek Orthodox School of Theology, successfully completing his MDiv. He then completed his postgraduate studies at the University of Chicago and began teaching at Holy Cross. Since 2000, he has been at Fordham University, and in 2006, he was appointed a tenured member of the faculty there. Aristotle's publications are too numerous to mention here, but I would say without hesitation that he is the leading Orthodox scholar in Trinitarian theology. And after his first publication in this area, with his book entitled Being with God, Trinity, Apophaticism and Divine Human Communion, Aristotle has published many chapters in books and articles in peer-reviewed journals in this area. Indeed, much of his most recent work in the area of political theology is grounded in the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. He's not afraid to engage with contemporary issues, doing so, however, in a manner which seeks to genuinely listen to the concerns raised, especially of the younger generations, but at the same time remaining faithful to the vision of Orthodoxy. Aristotle, we look forward to your keynote address this evening titled From Sophia to Personhood, the Development of 20th Century Trinitarian Theology. Friends, please take a seat.
Together with the essence and energy's distinction, that's a whole other lecturer, is Vladimir Lossky. This is attributable to several factors, not least of which is the small little book, The Mystical Theology of the Eastern Church, which is a mini-systematic theology. If you think about it, in the Orthodox tradition, there are very, very few systematic theologies, and Vladimir Lossky actually produced a kind of mini one. He wrote this book in 1944 in French, and it was translated into English in 1957. The English translation of this book is significant because it became one of the very few books on Orthodox theology in the English language that existed at the time, and it had a profound influence on shaping the ecumenical perception of Orthodox theology. As my doctoral advisor David Tracy once admitted to me, we read Lossky. Aspects of Lossky's theology became standard in contemporary Orthodox theology, and his theology of personhood in particular became a lens both to interpret Trinitarian theology and Christology, but also for understanding the human person's relationship with God. The standardization of a Lossian interpretation of the Fathers can be seen in John Meyendorff's influential book Byzantine Theology, in Alexander Schmemann's Liturgical Theology, in Caliphus Ware's writings, and even in Lars Funberg's magisterial study on Maximus the Confessor, Microcosm and Mediator. The most obvious influence is in the philosophy of Christos Yanaras, who in a personal conversation admitted to me that he started with Lossky, and in the theology of John Zizoulas. Zizoulas has admitted to being influenced by Yanaras, and if he does not admit of a direct Lossian influence on his thought, then it is surely indirect through his own theological development of the ideas in Yanaras' well-known book, Person and Eros. Only recently has Zizoulas admitted to the affinities that exist between his and Lossky's theologies. But Yanaras and Zizoulas are among the Greek theologians who are known in Greece as the generation of the 60s, and who broke from the dogmatic manuals of Vendelas and Ambrutos, primarily by being influenced by the Russian emigre theologians, and in particular Vladimir Lossky, whose mystical theology was published in Greek in 1964. In trying to understand contemporary Orthodox theology's understanding of person, no matter where we turn, Lossky is always. The theology of personhood developed by Lossky, together with other aspects of his theology, including the centrality of the essence-energies distinction, was uncontested for several decades within Orthodox theology, and, as I indicate, was highly influential within Orthodox thought in the 20th century. It also shaped non-Orthodox perceptions of Orthodoxy. It was not until the mid-1980s that we see the first real challenge to the patristic basis for this theology of personhood, which was given by the Belgian Franciscan scholar André de Haven, and which was directed to Zizoulas' development of this Orthodox theology of personhood. Zizoulas' well-known book, Being as Communion, was not published until 1985, so de Haven was responding to Zizoulas' book, Lettres Ecclesiales, and as is well-known, most of the essays in this French book became part of the English Being as Communion. Not long after that, criticisms were forthcoming, primarily of Zizoulas' theology of personhood, from Jean-Paul Larcher, Metropolitan Hierocles Vlachos, Savus Arouridis, Jean Panagopoulos, Lucien Turchescu, John Baer, Louis Ayers, and Nicolaos Ludovicos. It is also clear that resistance to this contemporary theology of personhood in its Zizoulian form played a key role in the recent Great and Holy Council, as the Russian delegation objected to this particular language in council documents and demanded the rewriting of those particular sentences that reflected a theology of personhood. All this, of course, before they decided not to attend the council. So where does that leave us? Is the contemporary theology of personhood most developed by Lossky and Zizoulas Orthodox? And how exactly do we make such a at stake in assessing this contemporary Orthodox theology of personhood is not simply an Orthodox understanding of the Trinity, Christology, and the human being, but the very task of theology itself. The criticisms are not simply about what it means to be person, but how to do theology that is faithful to the tradition. In many ways, it is about the very meaning of tradition as a living tradition. In my address tonight, I want to further unpack this overview of contemporary Orthodox theologies of personhood, and in so doing, I want to both disagree and agree with its critics. I want to agree with its critics that theologies of personhood, as we read them in Lossky and Zizoulas in particular, are not exactly to be found at the Fathers, but I also want to argue that that is okay. These are legitimate criticisms that could be leveled against, there are legitimate criticisms that could be leveled against Locke and Azulis, but whether they are faithful to the Fathers of the Church all depends on what one means by being faithful to the Fathers of the Church. I agree with the critics that it would be difficult to find the Fathers an articulation of theologies of personhood as developed by Locke and Azulis, but, as I've argued elsewhere, Locke and Azulis can be interpreted as consistent with the Fathers insofar as they developed a patristic distinction between hypostasy and nousia on the basis of the principle of divine human communion, or theosis. I will thus disagree with the critics in defending contemporary Orthodox theologies of person as offering genuine Orthodox insights into both Trinitarian theology and the question of what it means to be human. And in so doing, I hope to demonstrate the hermeneutical and existential dimensions that are inescapable in the task of doing theology, even for the Fathers of the Church, and which can be justified on the grounds of the Incarnation itself. And in so doing, for your reference, I amplify points made in an article I wrote, Tradition as Reason and Practice, which was published in the St. Vladimir's Theological Quarterly in 2015, where I draw on Alistair MacIntyre's understanding of tradition as being constitutive of and constituted by rational inquiry, as a way of making sense of the Orthodox understanding of tradition, and thus theology as a lived experience. But first, we must begin with Vladimir Locke, since, as I said, no matter where we turn to contemporary Orthodox theologies of personhood, we find Vladimir Locke lurking in the shadows. The basic idea in Orthodox theology of personhood is that it is built upon a distinction between person and nature, where person is identified with freedom and nature is identified with necessity. When I say that person is identified with freedom, I do not mean that freedom for unlimited choice, but an existential freedom from necessity. Nature is thus identified with a kind of necessity that personhood ecstatically overcomes and transcends. As Locke himself explains, quote, person signifies the irreducibility of man to his nature, irreducibility and not something irreducible, or something which makes man irreducible to his nature, precisely because it cannot be a question here of something distinct from another nature, but of someone who is distinct from his own nature, and of someone who goes beyond his nature but still retains it, who makes it exist as human nature by this overstepping, and yet does not exist in himself beyond the nature which he anipostasized and which he constantly exceeds. One of his more elegant quotes. Elsewhere he elaborates that, quote, the idea of person implies freedom vis-a-vis the nature. The person is free from its nature, is not determined by it. So for Locke, the person-nature distinction originates in Trinitarian and Christological thought. The basis for theology, according to Locke, is the Incarnation, which is the revelation of the full divinity of the Father in Jesus Christ. In the Incarnation, we witness simultaneously the revelation of the Trinity as a primordial fact, and the challenge is to discern the language and categories that would express this antinomic nature of God's being as Trinity, as simultaneously one and many. Locke argues that the brilliance of the Cappadocian Fathers was to draw from the Greek philosophical categories of hypostasis and ousia, where ousia would point to that which is attributable to all persons of the Trinity, and hypostasis would refer to what is irreducibly unique to each of the persons, that is, the Father is not the Son, etc. What was brilliant, according to Locke, was that hypostasis was synonymous with ousia, thus cementing the important point that the three hypostases of the Trinity were also of the same ousia. In this way, the distinction affirms the antinomy of God's Trinitarian being, but also when thinking of either pole of this identity, hypostasis or ousia, one is always referred to the other side of the antinomy. There is, however, one more important aspect of Trinitarian thought, that is, two contemporary theologies of personhood, which is the monarchy of the Father. Against Western notions of the filioque, Locke defends the monarchy of the Father, but in so doing also highlights another aspect of personhood in addition to irreducibility to nature, and that is freedom from nature. As Klosky argues, quote, what the image of causality wishes to express is the idea that the father, being not merely an essence but a person, is by that very fact the cause of the other consubstantial persons who have the same essence as he has. The procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father alone, by emphasizing the monarchy of the Father as the concrete principle of the unity of the three, passes beyond the dyad without a return to primordial unity, without the necessity of God retiring into the simplicity of the essence. In Lossky's Trinitarian theology, we thus see that a person is something distinct from nature, and in one sense identical to nature, though still distinct, but in another sense over and against the necessity that is inherent in nature, even God's nature. This tension between an understanding of nature as a shared reality and that over and against which person is defined would be transferred to Lossky's understanding of the spiritual life. Although he cautions against an easy one-to-one correspondence between God's Trinitarian being and the human person, Lossky uses the categories of person and nature to understand the spiritual. The movement toward theosis for Lossky is one of realizing irreducible uniqueness and is a freedom from the necessity inherent to created nature. For Lossky, the movement toward irreducible uniqueness that is theosis is not a negation of nature, but a movement beyond its inherent finitude, but also a reintegration of its fragmentation that was caused by sin. As Lossky states, for the creature, who is both physical and hypostatic at the same time, is called to realize his unity of nature as well as his true personal diversity by going in grace beyond the individual limits which divide nature and tend to reduce persons to the level of the closed being of particular substances. The most important point here is that for Lossky, the categories of person-nature map onto the antinomy between freedom and necessity, which will come to define later developments of Orthodox theologies of personhood. Now, Vladimir Lossky presents his own theology as a genuine retrieval of patristic theology, which is especially clear when he juxtaposes the, quote, God of the philosophers against the, quote, living God of the fathers of the church. And it is absolutely clear in Lossky that, in addition to scholasticism and neo-scholasticism, Bulgakov's sophiology leans more on the side of the God of the philosophers than the living God. For Lossky, the slide toward the God of the philosophers occurs when theology is not sufficiently emphatic. The antinomy, however, between nature as necessity and hypostasis as freedom is actually attributable to Sergius Bulgakov, even if Bulgakov never developed the theology of personhood with which we are now all familiar. This antinomy between necessity and freedom in human subjectivity is also discernible in German idealist philosophy. There are those who could argue that Bulgakov uncritically appropriated German idealist philosophy, which seems especially evident when he relates the phenomenology of spirit to Trinitarian theology, a move Lossky criticized. Bulgakov himself, however, indicates that the distinction between freedom and necessity has its roots in the Christian Trinitarian Christological controversy. Regarding the Trinity, he states that, quote, deduction is incapable of establishing the fact of divine triunity, which is given by revelation. But thought is called to fathom this revealed fact to the extent this is possible for human knowledge. Throughout his corpus, but most especially in The Comforter, Bulgakov traces how the categories of hypostasis, prosopon, and ousia with the Christian attempt to fathom this revealed fact. And this distinction maps on to the freedom-necessity distinction. Bulgakov has also, unlike Lossky, not shy to criticize patristic thought in order to bring its many accomplishments to completion with insights drawn from German idealist philosophy. For example, he has no problem making such statements as, quote, Fichte showed convincingly, the creaturely I is in its freedom connected with necessity, with the not-I, which reflects and limits it, end quote. Bulgakov himself sees his own understanding of Sophia as the Trinitarian being of God as self-revelation, as further developing what was left unfinished in the patristic literature. This is indicated not simply by the content of The Comforter, one of the books of this trilogy, but by the very structure itself, where a historical analysis of patristic thought on the Holy Spirit is abruptly halted, and one encounters a dense phenomenological account of the self-revelation of spirit, after which Bulgakov continues with the historical analysis of the Filioque. So he does history, theology, and then he goes back to history. The reason that the historical account of the Filioque occurs after the self-revelation of spirit, because for Bulgakov, such a phenomenological account of the self-revelation of spirit, which is Sophia, is what is lacking in the patristic attempt to make sense of the revelatory fact of the Trinity, which for Bulgakov is the revelatory fact of divine human communion. The discussion of the Filioque occurs after his phenomenological account of the self-revelation of spirit, because for Bulgakov, the Filioque was an unnecessary detour in which both sides are complicit and which obfuscated the issue. In other words, it precluded any progress on attempts to fathom this revealed fact. As he states clearly, quote, from the point of view of positive dogmatics, this millennium and a half logomarchy pertaining to the procession of the Holy Spirit was totally fruitless. Although one can identify the distinction between hypostases prosopon ennousia and the Trinitarian Christological controversies of the 4th century, the mapping of the freedom-necessity distinction onto the hypostasis-usia distinction resulted from Bulgakov's engagement with German idealist philosophy. As he states, quote, in the creaturely spirit, nature is givenness for unfreedom. It is necessity that is realized in the freedom of the person, end quote. Bulgakov, however, does not see such a development as an unauthorized invasion of philosophy into theology, since he sees the German idealist appropriation as indebted to early Christian debates, and in this sense somewhat continuous with this patristic tradition. As a result of this continuity and discontinuity between German idealist philosophy and the patristic tradition, Bulgakov has no problem admitting that the phenomenology of the self-revelation of spirit is in fact what was needed to bring to completion the patristic insights on the Trinity and to account for divine human communion. After first affirming in The Comforter that, quote, it is proper to spirit to have a personal consciousness, a hypostasis, and a nature as its self-revelation, and the life of spirit consists in the living out of this personal self-revelation and its nature, Bulgakov then states towards its last pages that, quote, not only is this revelation of the Father about himself the sweetest of religious truths, but it also contains the solution to all the difficulties of philosophical speculation. For Bulgakov, however, this appropriation is critically used against such philosophers as Fichte, Schelling, and Hegel, as he argues that only God's Trinitarian being as Sophia, which maintains the hypostasis usia antinomy, even as it transcends it in free necessity and necessary freedom, cannot account for how God's being is such that God creates the not-God for communion with God's very existence. Now, coming full circle, Lasky's own theology has been interpreted as part of a genuine neo-patristic retrieval of patristic theology over and against the philosophically tainted theology of the West and of Russian religious thought. It is clear, however, that Lossig's theology of personhood in terms of the freedom, necessity, antinomy is itself constructed and indebted to his own context, especially the theology of Sergius Bulgakov, even as Lossig was attempting to define his theology against that of Bulgakov's. Lossig's dependence on Bulgakov is further supported by the fact that all of Lossig's major categories, antinomy, person as freedom versus nature as necessity distinction, kenosis of the Son and kenosis of the Spirit, individual versus person, Even the phrase the Trinity is a revealed primordial fact are all found in Bulgakov. Bolotsky presents them as emerging from the patristic tradition. As one of many examples, although there does not exist a Greek word for antinomy, Bolotsky does not hesitate to discuss the relation between apophatic and cataphatic theology in Dionysius the Areopagite as an antinomy, which again he inherits from Bulgakov. It appears as if Bolotsky is co-opting the central categories of Bulgakov and apophaticizing them, so as to present self-consciously an anti-sophiological theology. This contextuality is further evinced in Bolotsky's identifying the essence-energy distinction as the most adequate to expressing divine-human communion and over and again Bulgakov's theology. Finally, and more directly related to the theology of personhood, Bolotsky argued for a more apophatic understanding of the personation distinction, both in Trinitarian theology and in the understanding of human personhood over and against Bulgakov, because he felt that only an apophatic understanding of the person-nature distinction could secure the freedom and irreducible uniqueness of the person. As he argues, quote, theological thought, which divides nature into its hypostatic and personality principles, as in the sophiology of Father Sergius Bulgakov, dissolves human personalities with their freedom and their relations towards God, the world, and a cosmic process of the return of the created Sophia to God. In the emergence of this contemporary Orthodox theology of personhood, we see the dynamics of theology as human hermeneutical, in the sense that one cannot really make sense of this theology of personhood without considering both the continuity of this theology with the tradition and the way in which this theology of personhood has absorbed the thought patterns of both modern and postmodern philosophical trajectories, as it attempts to confront the questions and challenges of the moment. I would further like to define this dimension of theology as hermeneutical in the sense that as one attempts to give expression to, articulate, and interpret, or render intelligent Christian truth, one cannot avoid being influenced by the questions and prevailing modes of thought of one's time and place. This is not to say that one simply maps theology onto a particular philosophy. Hermeneutical contextuality simply affirms that as one engages one's own tradition, one cannot escape doing so without having already absorbed the questions and language of particular modes of thought of a given time and place. Such a hermeneutical contextuality denies that there is an identity to ideas, which often migrate across various intellectual systems and worldviews. Such a hermeneutical contextuality is evident in the Fathers of the Church, with the appropriation of such language of hypostasis and ousia, and in many other ways. It is also evident in Bulgakov and Bolotsky. What unites Bulgakov and Bolotsky with the Fathers of the Church across time and in distinct places is their concern to faithfully and adequately articulate the realism of divine-human communion. And it is through this attempt at expressing divine human communion that one can trace the genealogy of the Orthodox understanding of personhood. Indeed, with this understanding of hermeneutical contextuality, I would argue that all Eastern Christian thought, from the moment of its inception, has been and always will be contextual. The theologian who has most developed this theology of personhood, and who is most associated with this theology of is John Zizulis, Metropolitan of Pergamum. In Zizulis' theology of personhood, I would argue that we see not simply the continuation of the hermeneutical dimension of theology, evident in the Fathers of the Church, and Bulgakov and Bolotsky. Hence, Zizulis continues the tradition of thinking on divine human communion. But evident also is what I would call an existential dimension, as Zizulis is concerned to articulate a theology of personhood that resonates with the experience of being human. According to Metropolitan John, and as is well known to this audience, personhood should not be attributed to any particular capacity of the human being, such as rationality or self-consciousness. Personhood is a relational event in which the human being, and through the human being all of creation, is constituted as irreducibly unique, that is hypostatic, and free, or ecstatic. This freedom as ecstasies is not a multiplication of choices, but a transcendence beyond the necessity surrounding the human being by the finitude of his nature, and beyond the existential necessity of nature caused by human sinfulness. Personhood is a Eucharistic event, and as such is the realization of the greatest commandment to love God with all of one's heart, mind, and soul, and to love the neighbor as oneself. It is an event of communion, of unity and difference, of the one, the many. Zizulis has not only demonstrated this understanding of personhood theologically in relation to Trinitarian theology, Christology, and ecclesiology, but has also shown how it is discernible in our everyday lives. He pointed us to the human creation of art, the analysis of the question, who am I, and the procreative act, in order to illustrate for us the human longing for uniqueness and freedom. I would add that this understanding of personhood is shown to be true by other examples, such as events of history or the suffering of a particular illness, and in so doing, extend the existential contextuality of Zizulis' theology of personhood. In other words, these examples further reinforce the degree to which Zizulis' theology resonates with dimensions of human experience. The Nazi concentration camps and the communist gulags are clear examples of structures and relationships that depersonalize the human being, constituting him as non-unique and unfree, while subjecting him to extreme forms of oppression. In such situations, the human being can claim to be unique and free over the oppressor, but the reality is such that this cry for recognition is ignored. The only basis for justifying this claim to uniqueness and freedom in the midst of oppression is an eternal relationship with God, who is eternally related to each human being in such a way as to always be constituting the human being as unique, free, even if the fallen conditions do not allow for the realization of such an experience of personhood. The relational understanding of personhood in terms of freedom and uniqueness is also clearly manifested in those who suffer from Alzheimer's disease, which is a disease that seeks to destroy one's uniqueness and freedom. For those who suffer from Alzheimer's, their capacity to remember the details of their own unique story or the people who are a part of that story disintegrates, and they are trapped in a world of confused thoughts and fleeting images. In such a state, the only hope for affirming the uniqueness of the Alzheimer's patient is through their loved ones who have always related to the Alzheimer's patient as Helen, Maria, George, or Seraphim, even as the Alzheimer's patient cannot remember their own unique name. We see another example of what I call existential contextuality in the Romanian theologian Dimitru Stanilor, who is similar to Zizulis in that he searches for that aspect in human experience that will allow for clarification and understanding of the dogmatic tradition. The dogmas are not sterile propositions, but must speak to the realism of divine human communion, and thus must resonate with life experience. Stanilor, Zizulis, Bulgakov all attempt to interpret the dogmatic tradition in light of some aspect of human experience, but Stanilor and Zizulis do so in a more exploratory fashion, rather than as with Bulgakov, who tries to locate a foundational grounding within the human experience itself. Whereas with Zizulis, the aspect of human experience by which he clarifies his Trinitarian theology of personhood is the human experience of longing for irreducible uniqueness and freedom of necessity, colliding tragedy with death and finitude. The point of focus for Stanilor is the movement of dialogue in relationships of love. In unison with all contemporary Orthodox theologians, Stanilor affirmed that humans were created for union with God. Human beings, like no other living beings, realize this union through a dialogue of love that God initiated from the moment of creation. Stanilor affirms the notion of creation as God's gift that initiates the possibility of an exchange of gifts between God and human beings, who function as priests of creation. This exchange of gifts is simultaneously a dialogue of love, enabling a personal communion between God and creation. The fact that the world was created for the purpose of communion between the personal God and human persons is a true revelation, confirmed by the human experience of freedom and relationality. As the Meloa states, quote, "It is only with other persons that man can achieve the kind of communion in which neither he nor they descend to the status of being objects of exterior knowledge used always in an identical way. Instead, they grow as sources for an inexhaustible warmth of love and of thoughts that are ever new, brought forth and sustained by the reciprocal love of these persons, a love that remains always creative, always in search of new ways of manifesting itself." That the human experience of love shapes Seneloa's Trinitarian theology is especially clear when he wrestles with the question of why a third in God. It is also in addressing this question that Seneloa's speculative tendencies become evident. In a way that is similar to St. Augustine and Richard of St. Victor, Seneloa argues that, quote, "It is only through the third that the love between the two proves itself generous and capable of extending itself to subjects outside themselves. Exclusiveness between the two makes the act of a generous overflow beyond the prison walls of the couple impossible." For Seneloa was an independent thinker in his own right. This particular quote reveals the deadness of Bulgakov. Inasmuch as existential contextuality offers confirmation of Zizoulas' understanding of personhood as irreducible uniqueness and freedom from necessity constituted in particular relationships of communion, it also indicates a blind spot in his understanding of personhood. This blind spot has to do with his lack of attention to the fact that love itself is not simply an event, but also a learning. The interpersonal dynamics of love as a learning is evident in Seneloa's theology, as Seneloa pays much more attention to what I would call the asceticism of personhood. There is an asceticism to personhood as a learning how to love that is indicated existentially in day-to-day existence and in the patristic tradition. Zizoulas never denies the importance of asceticism, but there is little development in his thought of the relation between asceticism and his theology of personhood. He gives the impression that personhood as irreducible uniqueness and freedom from necessity is exclusively a Eucharistic event, that which is constituted in and through the Eucharist. And although the realization of personhood as an hypostatic and ecstatic event occurs in the Eucharist through the eschatological inbreaking of the Holy Spirit, St. Maximus the Confessor, in his 400 chapters on love, helps us to understand that the virtue of love is something that must be learned. It requires humans to engage in ascetical practices that allow us to acquire the virtues, which then form the building blocks for acquiring the virtue of virtues, which is love. St. Maximus offers a relational understanding of the virtues in which virtues build relationships while vices destroy relationships. Says, quote, "All the virtues assist the mind to pursue the divine love." This acquisition of personhood is the realization of a Eucharistic mode of being in the world, in which the person relates to others in the world so as to enable further realizations of this Eucharistic mode of being in others and throughout all of creation. This asceticism of personhood is not one that manifests itself in being judgmental or legalistic, but as a living the truth even in relation to those who have yet to discover it. This asceticism of personhood is a struggle to overcome all that which obstructs the realization of our uniqueness and freedom, which includes our own insecurities and fears, as well as the sin that is committed against us. Finally, this asceticism of personhood is the realization of the greatest commandment: to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and to love your neighbor as yourself. The fact that our personhood has freedom from necessity and irreducible uniqueness is realized through an asceticism of personhood as a Eucharistic mode of being in the world is confirmed existentially, not simply through the dynamics of interpersonal love, as suggested by Seneloa, but also by negative human experiences, including the experience of violence. Recently, in my research, I have been exploring the effects of violence on learning how to love. And in so doing, I am following Sinaloa and Zizulas in trying to think our tradition in relation to what I have been calling existential contextuality. But the form of contextuality that I am highlighting is what I would call, following Edward Skillebeck's, contrast experiences within human existence. Specifically, the question I want to ask is whether the orthodox theology of personhood as free from necessity and irreducible uniqueness makes sense in light of these contrast experiences, specifically the human experience of violence. First, it is absolutely clear that the experience of violence leaves an existential mark on the human person. It is often thought that when one is threatened by or suffers violence, or even commits violence, once the violence is stopped, the person is unaffected. This assumption is wrong. Neuroscience is now able to show that the experience of violence, and even the committing of violence, leaves a trace in the body that makes the learning of love difficult. Trace in the body has to do with the actual physical effects on the formation of the brain that have to do with how we regulate fear and anger. For St. Maximus the Confessor, the greatest obstacles to learning how to love are anger, fear, and hatred. The traces of violence are manifested in the form of not being able to be in public places, such as restaurants, not sleeping, having nightmares of killing spouses or children, especially with war veterans, and many other such similar symptoms. Thus, this trace in the body can be explained in terms of being locked into a kind of necessity that tragically prevents the fulfillment of one's longing for freedom from the existential effects of violence. Insofar as it makes being in a relationship difficult, it makes love difficult. By so doing, it also tragically prevents the realization of our longing for irreducible uniqueness in relations to communion. In one sense, the effects of violence offer further confirmation of the orthodox theology of personhood in terms of freedom from necessity and in irreducible uniqueness to relations of communion. What situations of experienced violence show is that violence subjects a human being to a state of existential necessity. And the deepest longing of those who experience the effects of violence is to be free from this necessity, or in the words of contemporary Orthodox theology, to realize personhood. What these experiences also indicate is that what is most damaging about violence is the capacity for relationality, in which this freedom from necessity is most realized. What situations of violence thus manifest is an absence in Zizulis' theology of personhood. So any attention to how personhood is realized as an act of freedom from necessity as communion of love. If personhood exists as irreducible uniqueness and freedom as ecstasies from the necessity of nature, then personhood is a result of an asceticism of personhood as a learning how to love through the acquisition of the virtues. Insofar as virtues build proper relationships while vices destroy such relationships, then the asceticism of theosis as personhood must be relevant to those attempting to undo what I would call the asceticism of violence. What's more, thinking about the healing of violence, in particular along the lines of practices and virtues, provides a way for intersecting the psychological literature on trauma and what is being called moral injury, and what is more well known, of course, as PTSD, with the ascetical mystical tradition on the formation of virtue and thus personhood. Connecting categories that are practices. This is the one who, with a lived experience of violence, must engage in a new kind of asceticism, one that replaces the asceticism of violence in order to combat demonic images impacting his relationship to self and others. One of the practices that wires the body for openness to love is truth-telling. And one can see the importance of truth-telling in treatments for both PTSD, such as exposure therapy, where the patient speaks repeatedly to the therapist's trauma in order to reduce the fear reaction to the memories, or adaptive disclosure therapy, where patients engage in imaginal conversation with the deceased for a compassionate, forgiving moral authority. It is also being discovered that the practice of yoga has been shown to help those who have experienced trauma. My basic point is that the experience of violence indicates that personhood as freed from necessity and irreducible uniqueness is not simply realized in the Eucharist, but through particular kinds of ascetical practices that manifest the virtues, and in so doing, increase the human capacity to form relationship and thus to love and be loved, which is a Eucharistic mode of being in the world. So my conclusion. Let me affirm that the orthodox theological notion of personhood as an event of irreducible uniqueness and freedom from the necessity of sin that has distorted created nature is one of the most important and enduring insights of contemporary orthodox theology, which again traces its roots back to Bulgakov, but which was most developed by Lossky and Zulus, and which I would argue, in spite of the protests of patristic theologians, is implicit in the Trinitarian and Christological debates of the patristic period. I would argue that this theology of personhood is an example of hermeneutical contextuality, insofar as it emerges through an attempt to interpret the tradition, but whose content is not intelligible without taking into account Bulgakov's, Lossky's, and Zizoulas' engagement with the questions and thought forms of their time. The line between what can be attributed exclusively to the fathers and to contemporary philosophers or even ancient philosophers is not easy to draw, as ideas migrate without identity and borders. I have tried to show how this understanding of personhood as longing for a personal uniqueness and freedom from the necessity of nature is also an example of existential contextuality, insofar as it resonates with the human contrast experiences of self-loathing, oppression, mental illness, and violence. I've also argued that this understanding of personhood needs to be supplemented with the aretaic anthropology of St. Maximus the Confessor, most evident in the theology of Dimitri Staniloi, who understood the ascetical struggle as a movement toward the manifestation of the virtues as building blocks toward learning how to love. The embodiment of the virtues is the realization of a Eucharistic mode of being in which the person is rendered irreducibly unique and free from the existential necessity caused by sin or being sinned upon. Put another way, the ascetical struggle to realize this Eucharistic mode of being is itself a true body and soul to learn how to love. If we put the two together, the contemporary Orthodox theological notion of personhood and St. Maximus' understanding of virtues, then we have a profound insight into the human condition that can illuminate the effects of violence on the human person. We also have the basis for a more positive relationship between person and nature, rather than the diametrical opposition that is implied, especially in the theologies of Lossky and Zizoulas. If the orthodox theological notion of personhood as irreducible uniqueness and freedom from the existential necessity caused by sin is understood in relationship to St. Maximus' understanding of the virtues, then the Orthodox would offer a theological anthropology that would correct the blind spots of just war ethics, that would disrupt the current philosophical and theological discussions of virtue ethics, and would provide the basis of a unique Orthodox voice to the Christian concern for social justice and for social theology, in the sense that the Christian response would not be limited to activism, but would see the training in the virtues as potentially mitigating the problems caused by poverty. The Orthodox often speak of theosis, but do not really know what to say about theosis in relation to situations of post-traumatic stress disorder, mental illness, violence, or poverty. A further hermeneutical and existential contextualization of the already contextual Orthodox theology of personhood through St. Maximus' understanding of the virtues would help us make theosis more worldly. Thank you.
thank you for your stimulating, challenging paper. I was not only fascinated by the way, well, the ease with which you were able to present the different schools of orthodox theology when it comes to the Trinitarian doctrine, but also how you found your place in those discussions with identifying the ascetical dimension of personhood that needs to be sort of further explored. But I was especially fascinated with the way that you tried to sort of apply these findings, especially to the issue of violence, which is what theology is all about. So really, friends, please once again, we have some time for questions, so I open the gathering to my two questions. So perhaps we'll get a microphone, and I'll ask perhaps that you say your name and just articulate your question in a succinct way. So, over there.
Thank you, Professor. I'll take a break from that. You mentioned skill-based and contextual theology, and I was wondering how much you're actually you yourself doing that. I know that with skill-based, you know, correlational contextual theology at the moment is an attempt to kind of salvage it in Catholic theology. You know, you've got your recontextualization theologians. My reading of skill-based and correlational contextual theology is that it's really profoundly anti-sacramental, and it's also actually profoundly anti-theosis. So I'm just wondering, if you do draw upon those sources, how do you see it as being positive towards sacramental theology and theosis?
Well, there's several questions there. I'm not an expert in skill-based, but saying that skill-based is not that sacramental, I think strongly is a pretty debatable point. And to say people like Rahner and skill-based are anti-sacramental, I think is, if everyone said that about Rahner, I would absolutely disagree about that. I find Skilodex quite Chalcedonian, but in the sense that he's challenged by certain questions and trying to think about how that Chalcedonianism really, in many ways, could be rearticulated to some extent. Now, we could disagree with him, and that's fine. But that's the one issue I would say. So the issue of contextuality is a big issue in contemporary theology, and I was always puzzled. I studied at the University of Chicago, and there was always this big debate between the University of Chicago and so-called public theology and correlational theology, and the Yale School of Limbeck and Fry. That division doesn't really exist anymore. It kind of still does, but in a different key. I was always really kind of perplexed because I never really understood how, in fact, this is coming from an Orthodox, I never really understood how theology is not correlational. In other words, that was one of the basic points of my paper. It's that, you know, even to say that it's theology is not correlational in many ways is correlational because you're somehow articulating that within a certain kind of thought form that you're drawing in a contemporary period. So, for example, Fry and Limbeck, who were very, very profoundly influenced by certain kind of turns in postmodern theologies of language. So, the basic point I'm trying to make about contextuality is, to some extent, within an Orthodox context, that there's no pure retrieval of the fathers, right? And there's no pure retrieval of the patristic texts. Now, in contemporary thought, how each tradition sort of both acknowledges and then negotiates that contextuality is where I see the real difference. What's very, very clear I'm happy to be corrected here, in the Roman Catholic world, what became clear are epistemological questions. And that never really taxed the Orthodox. So to some extent, the kind of contextuality that we see emerging, in many ways, has something to do with the kind of central question, the kind of question that becomes central to the tradition at the time. And I do think, to some extent, that Bulgakov was kind of concerned with epistemological questions, but he saw it much more in a broader cosmological vision. So, but what's fascinating about the Orthodox is that, this is really remarkable. I mean, because you have to, you know, for those of you who don't know, you have to kind of see this, you have a kind of strong intellectual tradition. There's a great deal of work now being done to much more detailed work about that sort of 12th, 13th, 14th century Byzantine period, which was really alive and quite engaged in many ways with Western scholasticism at the time. There's a guy named Christian Kafsky, PPS, or Marcus Plessy, who's doing a lot of great work in this area. And then, this is going to be a little bit controversial, but there really was a Dark Ages in the Orthodox world. And, you know, because you can't really develop an intellectual tradition while you're, you know, concerned with survival. Now the Russians, you know, what's interesting, and I still haven't gotten a clear understanding why, is that the Russian intellectual tradition really didn't get jump-started until about the 18th century. And it had something to do with Peter the Great's reforms and a reaction against it, right? So my point is that what's actually really remarkable about the Orthodox is that they came back to they came back to a kind of theosis as their core. And that's absolutely clear in the Slavophile, it's absolutely clear in Bulgakov, it's absolutely clear in Soloviev. And somehow that core shaped the kind of conceptuality we see in Orthodox theology. So I think the two basic points is that theology is always contextual. It's never non-contextual. But the kind of sort of contextual theology that we see kind of being shaped within various traditions has much to do with what emerges as the kind of central question for the traditions themselves. Now, what I see happening within theology more broadly is a wonderful convergence on the notion of theosis. You see this, first of all, I think it's affirmed that people like Rahner and Balthasar, and even later Roman Catholic theologians now. I think there are Lutheran theologians in Finland and even elsewhere in the United States who are now trying to look at theosis in Luther. So there's a remarkable convergence on this, and I think I'm almost tempted to write an article, you know, for a high level theological journal, you know, the new consensus in theology, because we seem to be so fragmented. And that would be great, because it's not so much like Lossky and Bulgakov and Semmelweis, they have disagreements, and that's, but they, not one of them would deny that ultimately humans are created for human with God. And who would then, who would want to deny it? I always draw kind of ironically on this on Anselm's, you know, that God is that than which nothing greater can be thought. Well, actually, there's something more, there's something greater that can be thought than simply God's existence, and that's a God that's going to be communion with the not God. And there's a wonderful book, I think it's called, I'm terrible at remembering books, but if you want, you can email me, but it's on theosis with a collection of articles that's very recent, within the past 10 years, and there's a fantastic essay on Anselm and theosis in that book, and that's the kind of work I think that we should be doing.
I just wondered if you could say a little bit more about contextuality, because, you know, in my tradition, which is Anglican, Episcopalian, to me, to some of us, contextuality is a really dirty word, because it stands over against tradition. And so I'm really fascinated to hear you reclaiming that, and I'm wondering how you're reclaiming it in a way that references the tradition. The tradition is something dynamic. So how do you see the relationship between those two? Because I think that would be very helpful to some of us in other traditions.
So my reclaiming it properly is very much influenced with my engagement with my own tradition, which tries to juxtapose or diametrically oppose tradition versus contextuality. Contextuality is something subjective, something that's fleeting in the moment, whereas tradition is the rock solidness and so on and so forth. And I guess, so even my own way of looking at it to some extent is influenced by my training and all that, but it's influenced by my trying to say something different within my own tradition. And it's actually influenced by, what's really fascinating is that all the Orthodox theologians, the contemporary ones, first of all, none of the fathers speak this way, but the contemporary Orthodox theologians talk about tradition as living. right? All of them do. Lorofsky, Stanoloy, you will not find one Orthodox theologian that will not talk about it that way. But then it becomes a question of what do you mean? What does that actually mean, that tradition is living? And no one, you won't find a very good explanation of it. Lorofsky has some actually good insights and some good thoughts and so on and so forth. And so I think that what I'm trying to do is trying to see living tradition as ultimately being constituted by I'm not trying to see contextuality and tradition as being juxtaposed. The tradition itself is tradition is living. It is not static. I think McIntyre can help us here in terms of seeing it as constituted by constituted. I forget the exact phrase now. Constituted by reason and McIntyre can help us here. But so I think McIntyre can help us seeing it as kind of a movement, let's say, right? And so I think what I'm trying to do is make the argument that tradition is not, I'm trying to help the Orthodox theologians who call it as living, and trying to get to move beyond this diametrical position and kind of merge contextuality and tradition, right? But that, of course, has to intersect with other considerations too, like what does it mean for a church as a body to be discerning, right? What are the core elements of this tradition? Like when does the, when does the tradition actually stop being the tradition? So for example, and this is somewhat a simplistic example, but it's hard to be a Christian without claiming that Jesus Christ is important. So there has to be certain things, right, for a tradition for itself to be identifiable. And I really think the core element in the tradition for the Orthodox anyway is this notion of theosis. Right? But what I want to argue is that as we see it, as we see this thinking, that there's just tradition of thinking on theosis, we see inevitably a contextuality in the sense that how it moves depends on the question you have to deal with right now and the thought forms that you have to draw on. Right. We have kind of, I don't really know what to call them, but you have people who kind of want to deny that there's contextuality in Orthodoxy, there's a purity to the tradition, as if these ideas came out of nowhere just within Orthodoxy. And they never give attention to the fact that, so much of Orthodox theological thought is grounded in an understanding of the soul that ultimately emerged within the ancient Greeks. So much of it, they took it for granted. And so I don't see any, that's just one simple example of a kind of contextuality. So I'm not sure if I answered your question, but I think what I'm trying to do is get beyond the diametrical opposition and see ultimately tradition as living, as inevitably entailing, always, the kind of contextuality.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Leo Walker is my name, and I'd like to thank you particularly for your exposition of the sort of bit of the history of contemporary Orthodox thought. That was very helpful. I just want to unpack this distinction between freedom and necessity. There's a form of necessity which is sort of mechanistic and sort of Newtonian, bit of positivity and all that sort of stuff. But there are other forms of necessity as well. So if I sign a contract to write a book, then I have a certain moral necessity to fulfill that. If I have, if I make wedding vows with a wife, then that entails certain moral necessities that I fulfill those vows. And it seems to me that's the nature of freedom. It's very tied in with that form of moral necessity. And to be free from that necessity is, in fact, to then fall into immorality.
Yeah. Yeah, so you hit the nail on the head in terms of a weakness, I think, in Orthodox theology. So, this is a great example of contextual theology in the sense that one of the reasons why the Walkabout is much more sophisticated than this, right? He talks about necessary freedom and free necessity, right? So he's much more sophisticated on seeing them as distinct, seeing as possible, as ways in which they can possibly be diametrically opposed, but ultimately that what a kind of cosmic vision for him means that this antinomy is somehow always in tension but without necessarily being collapsed, right? So he was really much more sophisticated on this question. Then what happened with Lossky and Zizoulas, especially Lossky, is that he engaged in a kind of polemic against both Bulgakov and neo-scholasticism. And he there was a guy named Theodore de Renon who basically said that the West begins with the one and all that. And a much more sophisticated reader of de Renon realized that he was not being so simple about what he was saying, but even Lossky himself said at one point, like, it doesn't really matter where you begin as long as you maintain the antinomy. However, he somewhat fell into the trap that somehow, Catholic understandings of the Trinity did prioritize the essence. And that's really what led to the failure of the Filioque and so on and so forth, and ultimately, it was a kind of ontotheology there in the sense that they're subjecting God to a certain kind of necessity and therefore not allowing God to be God. So even Lossky's struggle with emphasizing a certain kind of diametrical opposition that's not so much an opposition had something to do with his polemics against Roman Catholic theologians of the time. I don't want to give a false impression. He was incredibly ecumenical. He had Gilson as his mentor. But, at the same time, much of Lossky's theology was formed over and against what he thought was Roman Catholic theology at the time. Right? So, I do think that you're right that fear of necessity is one of the most difficult philosophical and theological problems. I think that Lossky, but then Zizoulas especially emphasized the distinction. Zizoulas has since been criticized for that. I actually think that criticism is a lot more has a lot more weight. He has since tried to modify that nature is not simply a negatively charged term, right? And I think that within Orthodox theology, there's a great deal of research within Bulgakov to try to quote to it, and then Maximus the Confessor to correct. But what's interesting in terms of the concept of nature is that, and I don't know where this will go, but in postmodern theology, nature is kind of a bad word, right? Nature, essence, are kind of not words that people want to use anymore. And so it'll be interesting to see whether there can be, you have people like Judith Butler calling, I think it was Judith Butler, maybe someone else, calling for a strategic essentialism. Calling for strategic essentialism. But so it'll be interesting to see whether there can be a way of thinking about essence or nature. So I say all that to indicate that that's the context we're in now. It would be interesting to see how Christians can think about an understanding of essence or nature that ultimately responds to the question being posed by certain postmodern thinkers. We could do two things. We could just say, postmodern thinkers, atheists, let's just ignore them. Or we could really kind of rise to the challenge and see whether we can think nature and essence in ways that seem to take into account some of their concerns about essence language. Because there's an interesting affinity. Their concern with essence language is that it ultimately leads to a certain kind of sameness that locks people in, right? And also leads to certain power dynamics. The Orthodox are actually very concerned with the same problem in relationship to God. So I think that we have to sort of just continue thinking about this in a way. But I think that you're right that if Lossky and Zizoulas were kind of framing things in this way, it's a little bit simplistic, and perhaps we can. And I think Bulgakov was much more sophisticated on this question.
Ian Coutts, thank you for a fascinating lecture. Did I hear you right that when you were talking about Lossky, that he might have borrowed unattributively from Bulgakov.
Yes.
If you'd been mocking and using Turnitin, you would be quite concerned.
Yeah, I mean, the thing about Lasky is, so you have to take into account, like, this could be just me, but it's sort of my history of reading Orthodox theology, right? You first learn that there is this neo-patristic recovery and so on and so forth, and Lasky and Florovsky and Bulgakov and the Russians were kind of the bad guys, and well, I mean, Lasky and Florovsky were Russian, but the Russian religious philosophers were the bad guys, and so we were just taught just ignore them. And we did. We did. And, you know, then, you know, this insight didn't really occur to me until I taught this course, Modern Orthodox Theology, in 2011, and we were reading Bulgakov, and the reason why we can come to these insights now, and many more, by wonderful, you know, theologians around the world, Orthodox thinkers, is because Bulgakov is being translated to English, right? And so all of us now are sort of, you know reading and. And it became very, very clear, like, through a class discussion, that there were a lot of similar phrases, right? And it just sort of occurred, like, oh my God, you know, Lasky is sort of presenting his theology as this recovery of Dionysius and others, but so many terms he uses to describe them are straight from Bulgakov. Straight from Bulgakov. So, you know, there's no greater example of contextuality than that. In many ways that, you know, he sees what's happening in Bulgakov. He kind of sees it as this influence of German idealism, which is, again, it's not as simple as that. He wants to kind of go back to the fathers. And then within the Roman Catholic world, we see that there's affinity there with the Rosicrucians, and Lasky knew Marathon, Lasky knew of Delubac and all that. All that was sort of occurring, and he was already a part of that. And contributed to it. And so he wants to go back to the fathers and so on and so forth. And as he does it, his going back to the fathers is employing the very terms of Bulgakov. Now, he either could have been really conscious of that and been like using them against Bulgakov, right? Like, this is the real way that you should understand your terms, but he never references that, never. Or he might not have been conscious of that, and actually really going back to Dionysius and Eckhart and others and just had these categories in mind as he was trying to make sense of these texts. And so it's an important point, because at least for Orthodox theology, this juxtaposition between this return to the fathers and either this sterile dogmatic manual style you see in Greece, or this tainted Russian religious thought in Russia, you know, with Soloviev and others, emerges this pure tradition of that's a myth. That's an absolute myth. And that helps us to see what theology is and where theology should go from here. Deacon Perry always asking the toughest questions. I'm not sure.
Thank you, Tully. It was wonderful to hear you are synthesizing all of this, and I've had the benefit of hearing you discuss these issues over several years. I guess two questions, they're not related really. One is about the role of the spirit in how we think about, you know, living tradition, or how we think about I guess the way that I was thinking about this is, what if we shouldn't be focusing just on who the historical influences were, but also on that person's, that theologian's own experience of God in the Spirit, and I mean that's tradition, right? The Spirit in the Church, you know, making Christ present in whatever context it is, and then being articulated. So that's the first question.
Let me get that one, because I always have a hard time. I have a hard time remembering things. I agree with that. I have to have a bit of a caution, though. So I'll explain. Let me do the caution first, and then I'll tell you where I agree with you. You know, recently in the United States now, we have this kind of fascination in the art world with this thing called toll houses, and we don't ask me what it is, but it's kind of a strange thing, which I never even heard of. Now, I've been studying theology since I was 14, and all of a sudden, like 6 months ago, I heard about these toll houses, which some in the Orthodox world are trying to make part of the dogmatic tradition of the church. And one of the ways that in which one of these monasteries is trying to really solidify, let's say, this is the dogmatic tradition of the church, is that they have this theology where, because the saint thought in theoria, that somehow now it's part of the dogmatic tradition of the church, which has never been part of, which has never been a, an argument anybody else has ever made within the tradition, but somehow, and it's even a wrong understanding of theoria, it's just a wrong understanding of what theoria is supposed to mean. So my caution, of course, is that we have to be very careful about when we speak in this way, in other words, that the experience of the saints and holiness should somehow feed into the theological tradition of the church. Now, with that said, of course, I don't want to deny that either, of course, and so where I want to affirm it, where do I want to affirm it is, one of the great lines that Vladimir Lasky has, and he really has some great ones, is that he says that in the end, and I actually really agree with him, he says in the end, dogma has to be lived, right? That's the end game. The end game is dogma to be lived, right? And it's very telling because he's like apophatic in the sense of like, let's not try to say too much here. Let's try to say just enough to kind of lead us toward what ultimately should be lived, right? And I think what I was trying to point to in many ways is that, yeah, that the end game is union with God. And so when we draw on people like, for example, Bishop Anthony Bloom from, or Father Sofroni, and their real intense experience of struggling with their own existential necessity, their fears, their hatreds, their insecurities, and that real, like that real, real deep insight into how they were really able to do that. Like you were speaking about Sofroni, and Sofroni uses many of these terms as ways of indicating a kind of realization of this union with God. But the one thing I love about Sofroni. And you know Sofroni better than I, but he just draws so much on his own personal struggle with this in ways that you don't necessarily see. I'm not trying to say they weren't prayerful people, but you don't necessarily see in Saint-Eloi and Lasky and others. And that's where I think Sofroni can be brought in, and people like Anthony Bloom and others great spiritual writers and fathers and ascetics of our church, in the sense that they're really struggling to figure out how to love more. And so I do want to affirm that aspect of the spirit, but I also would say just one last thing, is that even there, that has to be brought into critical conversation and dialogue as well, because it's a kind of, it's a two-way street, right? That was the great point of Lasky. In other words, what you state matters and how you're formed, but how you struggle to live that also feeds into how we continue to understand it.
Thank you. And just
the second one.
The second one, if I can, is you, in speaking. This is much more practical, I guess. In speaking about the virtues and the doing and undoing of virtue through violence and post-traumatic stress and things, and even I really appreciated your example about Alzheimer's. I'm wondering if you've thought about human persons who never had the opportunity to express their personhood before a trauma or before an illness like Alzheimer's. So I'm thinking, for example, of someone who is severely and profoundly disabled. Do you have any insight or any thoughts on how we understand their potential for divine human communion if it doesn't seem that they are able to really freely respond to God in some sense, or?
Yeah. I would say a couple things I want to say here is one is, I didn't have a chance to develop it, I only hinted at it here, but I think there can be a misunderstanding a little bit with linking virtue and violence, because it makes it sound as if I'm trying to say that someone like a war veteran who experienced trauma is, should just try to be better to be moral. But that's not what I'm really saying. I guess And Deacon Perry is an editor of a book that's coming out now on Orthodox Perspectives on War, and I expand a little bit more there what I mean. And that book's coming out, by the way, soon at the University of Notre Dame Press, so look for it on Amazon. I'm going to put it right here. It's missing face here. So, and that's not what I'm saying at all, in the sense that, you know, what I'm really trying to say is that by thinking about the Orthodox understanding of communion with God, that virtue can also, virtue stops becoming simply a moral category and becomes an existential category. In other words, it describes the whole being, the whole person. So it includes the moral, but much more, right? So there's a real existential state that violence causes. And virtue doesn't mean that, you know, the victim is now becoming a better moral person. Virtue simply means that the person who is affected by violence is engaging in kinds of practices that enable certain capacities to love again. Because, you know, violence can make, does not necessarily make, but can make love difficult. Now, in terms of your question itself, this is why I think I call it asceticism of personhood, because I think that I'm finding more, and this is, I believe this is incarnational as well. Like, I don't think that theosis, by making theosis more mundane, more worldly, I don't think that it's a one-size-fits-all. And, you know, I think the Orthodox can give that impression by thinking of theosis of, you know, the St. Seraphim in the forest, and or St. Anthony with struggling with the demons and other things, and I, definitely those things. But I also think that we should be challenged, I think, more worldly. Like where is a person now in their particular place, in their particular history? And I actually believe theosis, given everybody's history, given who they are, given their capacities, given their, that theosis, you know, communion with God will look differently. I can respond a little bit to the situation of trauma because I've studied it, and I have come to believe that you know, trauma does not have to be defining for a person's capacities for love, right? There can be transformation. I can't speak to other situations of disabilities where capacities are different. And I think that all of us as humans and as Orthodox need to learn more. And there's a great deal of work, you know, being done more in terms of theology of disabilities and other. So I just think we need to learn more, right? But more generally, I would say that I think theosis is not a one-size-fits-all. I think it depends on the person in the particular history, the particular moment, the particular experiences, and that somehow, but I do believe, like in St. Paul, I ended this yesterday when I was speaking in Melbourne, that, you know, that, and now I'm paraphrasing because I have such a bad memory, but that nothing, you know, nothing, no, either angels, nor powers, or demons, or anything can get in the way of the love of God in Christ Jesus. I mean, I do believe that. And I think we just have to continue to struggle to understand it more in relationship to where it is. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. That's helpful.
Thank you.
Other comments?
Really, thank you. All of us really appreciate the presence here. Moving away from the fathers, I'm just wondering, somebody like Kazantzakis, how do you see his addressing of violence and war and everything that he tried to bring down to the human level? I mean, I'm not that much of a reader of him, but yeah. I've heard he has certainly made a big difference in drawings. So it would be good to hear how somebody like this, just from yourself, certainly made a big difference. You know, understanding and trying to deal with violence and what happened after the wars, etc.
Yeah, it's a good thing the Archbishop's not here because I have to admit now that I haven't read much of Cousin's life. And I can only thank you for pointing me in the direction that I wouldn't have thought of going, in the sense of seeing someone who is nurtured in a Greek Orthodox tradition, and I know there's controversy surrounding him and all that later, but somehow someone, but you know, like I said, contextuality, right? I mean, whatever it is, whatever happened at the end there, you know, President Dykes was you know, formed within a very Orthodox environment. And Steiner, also a famous postmodern philosopher, also is born in an Orthodox environment. You sometimes wonder how Orthodoxy sort of affected her own way of thinking about things. So I just thank you for pointing me in that direction, because I haven't read Orthodoxy enough to kind of be able to comment on. But it's a good. I am fascinated to see, because of his own background, to see how Eastern Orthodox ways of thinking might influence or shape the way he talks about those kinds of experiences. Back there.
In the acknowledgement of Bulgakov's ideas of necessity and freedom and Lossky's ideas of the hypothesis of the Trinity, to what extent is that sort of maybe as fruition of contextual theologies, to what extent is that limiting of previous contextual theologies or even the traditions of the Church Fathers?
Yeah. Look, I mean, it's definitely contextual theology. I guess, again, the tradition as living is to see that it never really stops, right? So it never is closed. Maybe that's the right way to put it. And, Bulgakov, I think, has been dismissed, and I think what's good now is that there can be a bit of a fresh kind of reassessment of what his contribution may have been, could have been. There are some now who won't even read him because somehow procedures of heresy were brought against him, and Rohr, I think, actually did declare him, his works are heretical. And I don't know what to say there, except the fact that Bulgakov was always painted as a kind of religious philosopher, and there's absolutely no question if you read him that he's a theologian. There's no question about it. And he is the first, in my mind, ever to actually trace a history of theological ideas in the East. None of the fathers ever did that. Right? They never created these history of Christian. They quoted from various other fathers, but they never created it. Bulgakov is the first, and he's probably influenced by people like Harnack and others who were doing it at the time as well, but he's the actual first. And then Lossky does it in his Vision of God, and then you see others now with John Baer and some others trying to do it in a different kind of way. But before Bulgakov, I defy you to try to find anybody in the East who created a kind of history of thought in ways that he could kind of trace the way in which the fathers were really struggling to make sense of how, in fact, the incarnation is possible. Right? What kind of God are we talking about in which there can be something like an incarnation? And of course, he felt an urgency at the time because he was trying to provide a cosmological vision that ultimately would refute what he saw as a growing Marxist and growing socialist and Marxist vision. But he knew that he was probably swimming upstream or against the tide, so to speak. Right? So I guess my answer to your question is, I guess the theology through the tradition is always contextual. It's not a question of, whether it's right or wrong, it's a question of continuity and discontinuity. And people have been arguing that Bulgakov is discontinuous with the fathers, and I would make an argument that that's false. Now whether the way that Bulgakov phrases things is the way we should continue to do it is a whole other debate, right? But that means that we keep moving and keep thinking about these kinds of things while being continuous with Bulgakov in the sense of trying to make sense of the fact of how it is that we can be in communion with God. I mean, it's really a remarkable thing that you have God and what is not God, and somehow God is greater than not God for communion. I don't think there's ever a way in which we cannot really think. I don't think there's ever a way in which we'll ever be able to stop thinking about how that makes sense.
I think time is up, so again, Ellie, thank you very much for speaking.